Sicha is chelik yud, vayigash aleph. Very geschmacke, fundamental sicha. That some fundamental topics will be discussed in this sicha here. We're talking about the reunion of Yosef and Binyamin. After not seeing each other for all these years, they meet in Mitzrayim and they cry on each other's shoulders. Pasuk is aleph. Ala pasuk vayipel al tzavri Binyamin ochi vayivk. Binyamin bacha al tzavarov, Yosef fell on the neck of Binyamin and his brother and cried. And Binyamin cried on his neck, on Yosef's neck. Yosef, the Gemara says, bacha Yosef al shnei mikdashin, Yosef cried on the two bate mikdash. V'heimar merumazim betevas tzavri, lashon rab, and therefore it says tzavri, the necks of Binyamin, because it was alluding to the two bate mikdash that would be she'asidin liyes b'chalkishon Binyamin, that will in the future be in the portion of Binyamin in Eretz Yisrael, va'asidin lichadev, and they're going to be destroyed. So Yosef was crying for this future churban of the two bate mikdash. Ubinyamin chulu b'chal mishkan shiloi she'asid liyes b'chalkishon Yosef asid lichadev, and Binyamin cried on mishkan shiloi, the mishkan that the Yidden built in the midbar, traveled with them into Eretz Yisrael, and then was situated in Shiloh, which is in the portion of Yosef. And then it was destroyed. And therefore, Binyamin cried for because of this churban that was going to happen in the portion of Yosef. So the first thing we have to talk about is what is the connection between a neck, tzavrei, and the Beis HaMikdash. Inei, hatam she tzavrei meramez l'Beis HaMikdash, the reason that tzavrei alludes, the neck alludes to the Beis HaMikdash. Before the medrash on the pasuk, "Mikdal David Tzavarech Tzavareich," the pasuk, the medrash on the pasuk that your neck is like the tower of David. The medrash says as follows: "Matzavar zeh nasan begavei shaladam." Just like the neck is in the high part, the high point of the person, kach Beis HaMikdash nasan begavei shalelam. So too, the Beis HaMikdash is in the high part or the high point of the world. The Gemara brings that the Eretz Yisrael is gavoya mikol haaretzes. Yisrael is higher than all of the lands of the world, and Yerushalayim is the highest part of Eretz Yisrael. And in Eretz Yisrael itself, the Beis HaMikdash is a begavei in the highest part of Yerushalayim, and therefore in the highest part of the whole world. However, remember we're talking about a neck, not a head. Mashakosu begavei shalelam, the fact that the Medrash says in the high point or the highest part of the world, it does not mean that it is the highest point of the whole world, that it's nothing higher than it, the peak. Says, brought in the Rashi as well, that the Gemara on the Pasuk Bank Seif Shachin, that he rests between the shoulders. So the Gemara says, the Beis HaMikdash namuch me'esrim v'shalish amam ein etam. That the Beis HaMikdash was lower 23 amos than ein etam. Ein etam is a well that from it is mentioned in the Gemara would flow an aqueduct to the Beis HaMikdash, which is what would fill the water in the Amo, in the aqueduct in the Beis HaMikdash. And this originated from a well called Ein Etam. And Ein Etam was the highest point of Yerushalayim. And the Beis HaMikdash is 23 Amos less than that, lower than that. Just like it's Havarei Shel Adam, Shehu Begavei Shel Guf, Elo Shehu Namuch Ma'at Me'aretz. Just like the neck, which is on the higher part of the body, but it's not the highest, it's a little bit lower than the head. On the contrary, it was bekavana this way, it was intentional this way. Because it says in the Gemara over there that they were thinking of making the Beis HaMikdash on the highest part of the world. Amri, they said, Nachzi Beipurta, let's lower it a drop. Because it says that it rests between the shoulders. Ein lechanoa b'shoyer yoser mikseifav, there's nothing more pretty or attractive in an ox more than its shoulders. The nicest part of the ox is the shoulders, and therefore the Beis HaMikdash should be at the shoulders of the world, not at the head of the world. Hainu de begavoi, that means that when it says in the other medrash that the Beis HaMikdash was begavoi shel oilam, it means besoich gavoi shel oilam, in the highest part of the world, but not totally at the peak. So, v'lecheda, what is the advantage and what is the beauty in the fact that the Beis HaMikdash is not in the highest part, in the top of the world? However you look at it, if there's no advantage in height, what is it telling us? What is it letting us know by telling us that the Beis HaMikdash is in the highest part of the world? And if the height is a mile, is something special. And he points out in Nara 6 that, for example, when it comes to the mitzvah of lulav, the bracha we make is al natilas lulav. Even though the esrig has both tam and reach, both taste and smell, which means that in a certain sense, the esrig is greater, more important than the lulav. Nevertheless, we make a bracha al natilas lulav because the lulav is higher and more visible than the rest of the dalad min, the other three minim. And therefore, it's all named the lulav because of its height. And also from the very statement of the Medrash, the Beis HaMikdash is begavoy shel olam, implies that there's an advantage to height. I would think that anything that is higher, yafamulu yeser, is nicer and better. So what's the purpose and the reason of making the Beis HaMikdash lower 23 amis from the top of the world? Either make it all the way on top, or anywhere else. Why make it on the top, but then lower it a drop? So to answer this question, we're going to learn a little bit about the neck. What is the inyan, the spiritual idea of the neck? We'll be able to understand this by first prefacing what is the idea, the concept of the neck. The neck is a memutza, an intermediary, between a bridge between the head and the rest of the body. The general life energy, the life force of the body, of the person, is in the brain, which is in the head. And the drawing down of this energy, this life force, from the head to the rest of the body, it's through the trachea, the esophagus, also called the windpipe and the food pipe, uvridin, and the arteries, shebegorin, that are in the neck of the person, in the throat. In other words, the life force begins in the head and then is transferred down through the neck into the body. And also, the brain is not just where the life energy of the person begins, but it's also where his intellect begins. And then the intellect has to go down to impact the rest of the body. So the same idea is with regards to Amshachas HaSeichel Me'amech Shebarash, drawing down Seichel, intellect, from the brain, which is in the head. Zesha HaSeichel Chitzeinu Yusei Nimshechu Ba Min HaMeach El HaLev. The fact that the Seichel, and he says here in parentheses, the Chitzeinius, because the actual brain remains in the head, but the expression of the brain goes down, because and it impacts the Midois, the emotions. So the fact that the expression of the brain goes down from the mind, from the brain, to the lev, to the heart, and from the heart, it then spreads out in its impact into the rest of the body, is only possible by going through the meitzar, the straits, or the constraints of the gorein, of the neck, which is separating the head and the body. So this idea, Meitzer HaGaron, is explained numerous times. In the Hora, he references Teira Eir. In Teira, he says very simple. He says, for the Seichel to become a Midah, it's a transformation. It's a whole new thing. Seichel, a person understands, Al Pi Seichel, that this is lovable. That this should be an Ava to this thing, to this person. Then that has to become a Midah of Ava, that he should actually love it. In order for the Seichel to become a Midah, it's creating a new entity. In order for a new entity to be created from the Seichel, there has to be a Tzimtzum. The Seichel has to be Mitzamtzum itself to allow for the creation or the birth of a Midah. And that's the Meitzer HaGaron. That's the constraints of the Gagarin, which is Mitzamtzum. It creates a Tzimtzum, a constraint on the Seichel to allow for a Midah to be born out of it. Ulafiza. So based on this, the neck has an advantage on the head because davke hatzavar hagoroin maybe lepeil v'tachlisa shalereish. The tzavar, the neck and the throat, are the conduit to be able to bring the head into its purpose. in two ways. Number one, that all the limbs of the body should receive their life energy from their life force from the head. And beis shekulam yisnagu al piyasechos beirosh, that all of the midos, all of the rest of the body, should conduct themselves according to the seichel, according to the intellect, in the mind. So both functions are only possible through the tzavar, through the neck, and therefore the tzavar has an advantage, because without it, the head can't function. Even though if you look at the head by itself and the neck by itself, the head is greater, which is why the head is physically higher on the body than the neck, which means the neck by itself without being near the head could accomplish nothing. And the head has seichel in it, and the head has chayis in it. So the head is clearly on a higher level than the neck. This advantage of the head, is only in the hierarchy of the levels. But with regards to the mission and purpose of the head, there's an advantage in the neck. And he mentions in Ara 8, from a maimer for the Physic Rebbe in Bereishis Tavshinei, that there's a difference between madrege and maila. Madrege means level. Level is something that is compared to others. So one could be higher than the other because it's next to something else that's lower than it. Maila is something that an inherent virtue that it has, something that it has inherently, that without comparing it to anything else, either it's a maila or not a maila. So the head is higher, on a higher level than the reish. But the tzavar, sorry, the head is on a higher level than the tzavar, than the neck. But the neck itself has its own maila. And specifically because it is lower in level. Because the neck is the conduit. And the neck, because it is lower than the head, has this ability to transfer the chayis, the life energy, and the seichel from the head to the body. So now we understand that there's a maila in the neck. The neck being lower, it's not just lower than the head. It has an advantage over the head. So now we can apply this to the Beis HaMikdash. Now this will be based on this, we'll also understand how it works with regards to the Beis HaMikdash, which is compared to a neck. That its main maila is that it is lower a little bit from the highest point of where it could have been. The whole idea of Beis HaMikdash is that through it, there should be drawn down and illuminate a light of Elokus of godliness to the whole world, ad lechelki achinomach v'tachtin madrega, until the lowest parts of the world. V'lachena, and therefore lehoya mishkan kiim bigovhei av legavei legamri, and therefore the mishkan was only in the height of the world, but not the highest point of the world. And not at the highest point of the world and too high for it, aloof from it. Because then it would be too high to be able to illuminate the world. But the Beis HaMikdash was built lower a little bit, with some connection and some closeness to the world, in order to be able to illuminate the world. Just like the neck, like we explained at length previously, just like the neck of the person, because it is lower than the aloofness of the reish. Sereimus literally means the height, the higherness of the reish. But in this case, the reish is a little bit removed. It's higher and removed from the head. And the neck is lower than that. The neck is closer to the guf. It is like the middle point that is able to connect the two parts, the head and the body, into one. The maimer in Teira Oir, I've seen Ara 7, he mentioned Teira Oir Noyach. I looked at the maimer in Va'eda, the Bir, and Lachain Emer. The maimer is Ba'arucha. It explains at length the idea of a Meitzer HaGaron and the idea of Mimutza. Over there, I think it says that Mitzrayim was the Meitzer HaGaron. So, if you want to learn more about this idea of the Mimutza, you could look it up in Teira Oir. Now, in the next paragraph, we're going to talk about the personal Beis HaMikdash, the person's individual Beis HaMikdash. And in this sikha, we're going to go back and forth a little bit between the Beis HaMikdash HaKlali, the Beis HaMikdash in Yerushalayim, and the person's individual Beis HaMikdash. The same application could be made to the person's individual Beis HaMikdash. Like we know, the Rebbe said thousands of times, they mentioned in Maimer Chazal, that every Yid is a Beis HaMikdash for the Yebishter. So the same thing, the same idea applies. We have to go to the Tzavar in order to have the Pu'ula and the Mata on the lower levels. Because when the Nefesh HaBamis doesn't elevate itself in a state of removal. Mino elam katan shalei from his world. Elam is asekes from his labeshes boy, but the nefesh alekis. It is involved and enclosed in the world of the person in the gulf. Bichdei levader lazachachas nefesh boy, in order to refine and elevate the nefesh abamis as gufay and his guf, ve'es chalke ba'ilam and his portion of the world. Alideze nasa kulei mishkan mikdash leir yisbarich. Then the whole person becomes a mishkan, a dwelling place, and a sanctuary for the Eibishter. But it's only if the nefesh elikis is involved with the nefesh abamis in order to work with it and elevate it. So now we understand the beauty of the neck, the advantage of the neck, the fact that it is able to convey the energy from the head to the rest of the body, and the fact that it's able to convey the light of the Eibishter into the world. Now we'll go back to the pasuk of Yosef and Binyamin. Yosef cried on Binyamin's neck, and Binyamin cried on Yosef's neck. Not only was it on the Beis HaMikdash, but also literally when they cried, so if it says he cried on his neck or on his shoulders, it was literally they leaned on each other's shoulders and they cried. So we'll understand why Yosef fell on Binyamin's neck and Binyamin cried on Yosef's neck. Why did they cry on each other's necks and not on their heads? Which the head is the primary and most important part of the person. Hello. This is why. The ultimate purpose of a Yid is K'maymer Chazal. I was created for the sole purpose of serving my Creator. To serve and to complete the purpose, the intent of his Creator. By creating this individual and by creating all of the elements. Shehi li is ledira b'tachteinim, which the kavana of the whole creation was to make a dira b'tachteinim. V'zeh, this avoid of this inyan of dira b'tachteinim, totally b'avedas ne'israel. This is totally in the avoid of the Yid, in the Yid's work, in the Yid's serving Hashem. Sharei hakel b'dei shamayim chut mi'ira shamayim. Everything that happens in the world comes from the Eibishter. Besides Yidus Shemayim, besides the person's Yidus Hashem, Shehiretzis Aveda Vikra Visharsha was Yidus Hashem. Yida is the primary and most important and the root of all Avedas, as it's explained in Tanya. And therefore, the Yida is the most important thing, and the most important Aveda. And Yida is not from the Yabishter. Yida comes through the person's Aveda himself. So Bameila, if a person wants to make a dira b'tachteinim, which means a person has to do his aveda, it has to come from the person. Sheheim yasu dira leiz barach b'tachteinim, that the Yid should work on himself to have Yiras Hashem, which through that he's able to do his aveda, which through that he's able to make a dira b'tachteinim. Al yidei shekol echad v'yachad mehem, through each Yid, yizachich his guf v'nafshi abamis v'chal kevelim, should refine his guf, his nefesh abamis, and his chelik in the world. And therefore, v'lachena ikir bazeh, and therefore mitzad the aveda of the person, the ikir is gam legavi b'chinas reish, even with regards to the head, the most important part of b'chinas atzavra shabay. The person's neck, shal yodei nishlemas aveda zukanal, because through the neck, as we explained at length earlier, the aveda could be done, because with the head itself, the ruchnius of the person, the remains separated from the gashmis of the person, from the rest of the body, and the neck brings the two together. So in order to do the aveda of dira b'tachteinim, of connecting the person to ilam hazeh, he needs to go through the neck. And this explains why Yosef and Binyamin each cried on the neck of their brother and not on the head. Aleph for 2 points. Aleph, number one, al reish shel ben Yisrael, al nishma sein lifkes. The head refers to the neshama, And the neshama, there's nothing to cry. Gam b'shas ha'chet, ho'yisa b'amnei t'yiz barach, because the neshama, even during a sin, the neshama was still faithful to Hashem. The neshama never left. The neshama always remained close to Hashem. So there's no reason to cry. The problem is lower down. And beis, tachlisa shel ben Yisrael, the ultimate purpose of the yid, in a b'reishay, is not in the head, meaning the neshama working on itself. The purpose of the yid is in the neck, which is lifil beguf benefesh benafshi abahamis ubechelkeb elam, to impact the body, and his nefesh abahamis, his animal soul, and his portion of elam kenal, as explained at length up until here. And therefore, if you're going to cry, cry in a place where it makes a difference. So number one, the head, there's nothing to cry about. Number two, there's no purpose to cry there because the head can't change anything. So therefore they cried on each other's necks because number one, that is where the problem begins. And number two, that's where the problem has to be fixed and could be fixed. So we now understand, betuv tam, what's the maila of a neck, sai in the person, and sai in the structure of the world. That the Beis HaMikdash is positioned, it was built in the part which would be considered the neck of the world, and why Yosef and Binyamin cried on each other's necks. You know, Gimel is going to introduce a new question, and that is, why do they cry on each other's Beis HaMikdash and not on their own? And then in Ois Dalid is going to introduce what is the whole idea of crying. We're going to explain what does crying even do. And we're going to understand a whole new approach in how to deal with the churban. Ois Gimel. Amram Tzarech Lahavin. We have to understand. Lama Bacha Yosef Ala Mekdoshes. Why did Yosef cry? Al Mekdoshes Bechelki Shel Binyamin. Why did Yosef cry on the Bati HaMikdash that would be in Binyamin's portion? Ubinyamin Bachal Amishkan Mechelki Shel Yosef, and Binyamin cried on the portion, on the Mishkan that was in Yosef's portion. Chayda, seemingly, Yadirabe, Kalechad Mehem Alav Livkez Alchur, Beis HaMikdash Bechelki Hu. Each of them should seemingly be crying on the Beis HaMikdash of their own Chelek. Hare Odom Karev Etzel Atzmi, a person's closer to himself. This is a reference in the Gemara Sanhedrin, when it comes to the halachas of Eidus, of testimony, that in order to give Eidus in the Beis HaMikdash, the halacha is that a karev is pasul Eidus, a person that's a relative, a brother, a father, a son, cannot give Eidus, cannot say testimony. Says the Gemara over there, that a person for sure cannot give testimony, even for themselves, even to incriminate themselves, because a person is the closest karev to himself. A person is more related to himself than his relative is. And he mentions in Nara 16 that you see that also in the person, that when it comes to expressing how you're feeling, when it comes to someone else, even if it's your father or your brother, you have to use words. A person can't always know what the other person is thinking or feeling. But a person themselves, without saying any words, just in machshava alone, in their own thought, they already know how they feel or what they're thinking. Because there's a sense of closeness that a person has to themselves that is even greater than to their closest relatives. The Yadkid, this whole person is close to themselves. The Yadkid, they kach, so much so. The Afilu mitzvah Avas Yisrael. Even when it comes to the mitzvah Avas Yisrael, the gamla fi yamavur ba chasidus, the geida lechusa vekamusa shel avazu, and even as explained in chasidus, in its great quality and quantity of this mitzvah. Im kozah, nevertheless, are ha'ava eina ba'ifin shel, eina ela, ba'ifin shel v'yahavta l'reach ha'kamecha, b'chaf ha'dimyin. The whole ava that you say, love your fellow yid as yourself, is kamecha, the chaf that says like, as, it compares one to the other, but it's only a comparison. Ve'ena magia mamish lo'isa amida shoye v'satzmen, but certainly does not reach the same level that a person loves themselves. As much as we're going to say that a person has to love another yid, he doesn't reach the love of a person's kamecha, as you love yourself. And he says in Nara 18 that even though Avas Yisrael is an Ava Atzmis, it's something that's coming from within, not necessarily something that has to be developed. But nevertheless, it could be compared to the Ava to a brother, which is also an Ava Atzmis. It's also something that comes from within, and not something that has to be worked on. But nevertheless, the love you have to your brother is not the same that you have, love you have to yourself. And also, as we see mentioned in Igeres HaKedesh, in Igeres Simen Tezayin, Be'esa Igeres Atzma Sheba Mayrech Ad Kamo Yesh Lahar Beis Matan Tzedakah. Shimi Desa Chesed, in the very same Igeres that the Alter Rebbe elaborates on how much, how important it is to give tzedakah, because tzedakah is the idea of chesed. Nevertheless, he says over there, that if a person only has one jug of water, the halacha is that your life comes first, which means to say if there's two people in a desert and they only have one jug of water and there's only enough water to give one of them to live, then the person who owns that water drinks that water and doesn't give it away. Because as much as he has a mitzvah to love the other person, he has a mitzvah to take care of himself first. So based on this, clearly and certainly each of them, it was more important to them. Their own Beis HaMikdash. So seemingly the crying should have been first and foremost on the churban, on the destruction of his own Beis HaMikdash. And how is it that they're crying on for the other person's churban Beis HaMikdash? Eitz Arach Lav, and now we have a second question. Till now we were talking about the reunion of Yosef and Binyamin. Yosef and Binyamin met each other and they cried on each other's shoulders. Now we're going to talk about the reunion of Yosef and Yaakov Avinu. The pasuk says that Yosef cried on Yaakov's shoulders, on Yaakov's neck, and then he cried even more. His Yosef continued to cry even more. Isa b'Zayar, the Zayar says, so Yosef b'chal b'Beis HaMikdash Nechrav. The Yosef was crying on the Beis HaMikdash that was going to be destroyed. And this is how the Zayar explains that he cried additionally, extra, more. And after crying on the Churban Beis HaMikdash, there was an additional crying, gam al golos basra al golos achiyachri, on the final golos, on this last golos. In other words, this golos, besides the fact that the Yidden went out of, we were exiled out of Yerushalayim, out of Eretz Yisrael, with the churban of the second Beis HaMikdash, this golos is a very, very long golos, a golos that has not yet ended. So Yosef was crying not just for the churban of the Beis HaMikdash, but he was crying for this long, extended golos. He cried extra because the golos is so long. Oh, so that's how the Zayar explains it. Rashi doesn't say this. Yosef cried because he hadn't seen his father in so long. But Alpi, the Zayar, Yosef was crying for the Churban Beis HaMikdash. Yes, let's Maya. So based on this, we have a question. Why does only Yosef cry on the Churban Beis HaMikdash and not Yaakov Avinu? But Yerutze, so Rashi's answer, the Shem Rabbi Seinu. So Yaakov Hoyakeda Shema, the Yaakov was in the middle of reading Shema, saying Shema. According to the Zayar, it's not a sufficient answer. According to the understanding of the Pasik, in the basic, in the simple understanding, he wasn't crying because of the Churban. He was crying because he missed his father. He was emotional. So then, according to that, the reason that Yaakov didn't fall back onto Yosef's shoulders and cry and kiss him is because he was reading Shema. So according to this, this emphasizes the greatness of the Aveda of Yaakov. That even in the moment that he was seeing his son for the first time, after many years thinking that he was not alive, nevertheless, he didn't stop saying Shema. Even more than that, Simcha Tzumazu, this incredible Simcha, did not distract him from having the proper intentions which we're supposed to have and the proper concentration we're supposed to have during saying the first Pasuk of Shema. Which means to say, Yaakov was saying Shema. Had he been disturbed or distracted by meeting Yosef, he would have stopped. He wouldn't have said Shema because he can't have Kavana. And Shema, Tzricha Kavana. The fact that Yaakov continued saying Shema means that Yaakov felt that he was able to have the proper concentration and the proper kavanah by saying Shema, which means Yaakov is on such an incredible level that this joy and this emotion of seeing Yosef, his son, did not distract him from saying Shema. So that makes beautiful sense, and it even emphasizes the greatness of Yaakov. But according to the Zayar, that Yosef was crying for the Churban Beis HaMikdash. The question is, how is it possible? That Yaakov was not emotional and not distracted by the Churban Beis HaMikdash. For Yochel B'Shoazu Likris Hashma B'Kavana. And was able to read, in this very moment, was able to read Shema with a proper, say Shema with a proper Kavana. So we have two questions. Number one, why do Yosef and Binyamin each cry on their own churban, on the other's churban Beis HaMikdash or Bate Mikdash, and not on their own churban? And number two, according to the Zayar, that Yosef was crying on the churban Beis HaMikdash, why does Yaakov not cry and instead read Shema? Now we're going to explain this. We have to understand what is crying. What is happening when we cry? And what does crying accomplish? When a person cries, literally, when it comes to material matters, personal matters, person cries, this is to make it easier for the person who's crying. It releases this negative energy and it makes him feel better. As we see literally, when a person cries for something that is bothering him or affecting him, this crying has no power to rectify that which has caused the crying. But he cried and he'll feel a little better. Like it says in Tehillim, my tears were like bread to me. They made me satiated. They made me full. The crying made me feel better, but it didn't fix anything. From this it's understood. I said, when a person is able to fix something, on the contrary, he shouldn't try to calm himself down through crying. A person should do and fix, rectify the problem. Therefore, when a person sees the destruction of the other person's mikdash, this could be on a personal level. A person sees the other person is in a state of churbin of his beis hamikdash. He could participate. He could empathize, and he could cry. But the main rectification and rebuilding of his beis hamikdash, is not dependent on him and the person, but on the other person whose beis hamikdash is in a state of destruction. He is able and therefore is obligated to help the other person in the following ways. Aleph, by telling him what he has to do in a pleasant way, teaching him what to do right. Beis, al yedei she'eir rachamim v'yispali l'alav, by being meir rachamim, by awakening rachamim, mercy upon him, by davening for him. Aval abitl bepeil shel achatoyim shegormu, but to actually get rid of those sins, those transgressions that caused that there should be a state of destruction in his friend's mikdash, is dependent only on his friend, because his friend is a Baal Bechira, has the free choice to do what's right, and he's the one who has to do the right thing to fix his beis hamikdash. And a person did everything to do, he can't help his friend. And nevertheless, he sees that after everything that he did for him, his beis hamikdash is still in a state of destruction. Then it hurts him, it impacts him greatly. And he cries for him, but he can't do more than that. In the Sikha, when the Rebbe, this is from Fabrengi, from Vayigash, there were some very geschmacke expressions in this Farbrengen. The Rebbe said, in Yiddish, the Rebbe said, Bui in Yenem is Mikdash, Bui in Yenem is Beis HaMikdash Kenenisht. A person can't build the other person's Beis HaMikdash. He could go on Mifzayim, he could give extra stokah, and he can daven in Mitahal B'Shtunda Lenger, he could daven a half hour longer for the other person. But more than that, he can do. Ulam. When a person sees his own churban beis hamikdash, as ein leli stapek banacho bebichia, a person cannot suffice by crying and by sighing. Now, out of 26, he brings the ayem yem teva pula achas melev anachas. One action is better than 1,000 sighs or 1,000 groans. This is an expression that was brought countless times by the Rebbe in letters and in sichas. And it actually originates from a letter that the Friedrich Rebbe wrote to a Yid in Rostov. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the Yid had suffered a loss in his family. But in the letter, the Friedrich Rebbe describes the difficulty of the situation. Bechlal, not just by this person's individual Yid, but the matzav of Yiddishkeit Bechlal in Russia. And after describing the whole matzav and how terrible it is, the Friedrich Rebbe ends with this vort of the Rebbe Rashab that teva pula achas melav anachas. It says nayemim over there azevis anacha ushkoid ba'avoda b'poyel v'yachnecha elekim. Leave, go away from the sighing, get involved in avoda b'poyel and doing actual avoda v'yachnecha elekim, and the Eibster will bench you. In other words, as bad as the situation is, if there's something that's your beis hamikdash, if it's something that's wrong within you, you have to fix it. You can't just cry. Person has to do everything he can to rebuild and fix his beis hamikdash, his own personal beis hamikdash, which will lead to the gula. There's an exception to the rule. If the tears, if the crying is tears of tshuva, then it's okay. Because then the crying itself is part of the building and part of the rectification. Like it says in the pasuk, place my tears in your pouch and you hold on to my tears because my tears have a purpose. But besides for that exception to the rule, tears don't work. You want to fix your beis hamikdash, you have to actually do something. Sometimes tears, not only they don't work, they actually have the opposite effect. They weaken his aveda. Because he says in his heart, he says to himself, I already was yotze. I already fulfilled my obligation by crying. The Rebbe told over a story in the Farbrengen about someone that the Friedrich Rebbe said that there was someone once who was crying by Hashamnu. So the Rebbe Rashab said that is Zichalein Moichel. You know, he already forgave himself. You know, he's crying so hard, he clearly forgave himself. He's certainly a tzaddik, said the Rebbe Rashab, but I don't know if the Rebbe Rashab said it or the Friedrich Rebbe used it as an explanation of the story, but he said nothing was accomplished. He cried and nothing was accomplished. Sometimes a person feels too good of themselves. I even cried. I felt bad. But how does that actually fix his beis hamikdash? Now that we understand what crying is, the crying taka makes a person feel good. Taka relieves the person of some of the stress of what he's going through, but it doesn't fix anything. So when it comes to the other person and he can't fix anything anyway, so then he cries because he has nothing else to do. When it comes to a person himself, where he could fix himself, crying doesn't work. He has to actually do something. Now we can understand what happened to Yisrael Binyamin. Therefore, the tears of the crying of Yosef and Binyamin was each on the other person's chelik, because on their own chelik there's no crying to do. You have to work. So Yosef cried on Binyamin's chelik because for the other person you're allowed to cry. And Yosef cried for Binyamin's chelik because he's allowed to cry for the other person. But to cry for yourself has no purpose. Oh. Now we have to answer the second question about Yaakov Avinu. Here, it's a little short, but it answers the question and then explains also why Yaakov was saying Shema. The question was why didn't Yaakov cry? So he says he's going to explain that Yaakov didn't cry, and not only that, but he was saying Shema, which was part of the solution. Yaakov did not cry in the Churban Beis Hamikdash. But he was saying Shema. Ki Yaakov is the father of all Yidden. both the Beis Hamikdash, the Batei Hamikdash, and the Mishkan, both Yesib's chelik and Binyamin's chelik is all considered his own chelik because he's their father. So everything is his chelik, and therefore he can't cry any of it because the Yesib, it's all his chelik. Therefore, he has to fix it. He can't cry for it. So the first question, the first detail of the was, why does Yaakov not crying? Because if it's his own Beis Hamikdash, he can't cry. Now, what was he doing? He was reading Shema, saying Shema, V'lochem. And therefore, what was Yaakov doing at this moment? Yes, there was a moment Yosef was crying for the Churban Beis Hamikdash. So Yaakov says, 1 second, I can't cry with you because it's my Churban. I have to fix it. V'lochem osak b'tikun b'nei Beis Hamikdash. And therefore, Taka Yaakov got right away involved with rectifying and rebuilding the Beis Hamikdash. How did he do that? By saying Shema. What's the connection? Sharei inyan Beis Hamikdash hu sheyeh bayis mukhan lekarbanos. The Beis Hamikdash is what, like we learned this in the past and previous. Obviously, this is from the Rambam, but we've discussed this in the past. Machlekes of the Rambam and the Ramban, that the idea of the Beis Hamikdash is that it should be a place for karbanos, place ready and prepared to bring karbanos. The chol akeda krishma, and anybody who says krishma nezakilu hikriv elachulu v'zevachulu, and saying krishma is like bringing a karbin. So b'meila, he said krishma. What's the connection of krishma and a karbin? Kikirin yina karbin hu adam kiyakriv mikem karbin l'Hashem. The whole idea of a karbin is that a person should bring closer from within himself, mikem, from within us, from within the Yid himself, we have to bring to Hashem. That's a karbin, which is the krishma, which is the same idea as krishma. U'mesiris nefesh haba, and the mesiris nefesh, that's part of krishma. Number one, when you say Hashem Echad, a person is supposed to be mechaved limser nafshe bi'echad, to be voice and nefesh when he says the Echad. So there's one area, one nekuda, where you see mesiris nefesh in Shema. Then later you say b'chol levavcha, b'chol nafshecha, afilu neitelas nafshecha, that your pasha is ready to love Hashem, even in a case where you're losing your life. So pasha mesiris nefesh mamish. So say in b'chol echad, and say in b'chol nafshecha, you see that Kriya Shema is the inyan of Mesiris Nefesh. So Mesiris Nefesh is the inyan of a carbon, because the whole carbon is to give yourself over to the Eibishter. And therefore, by saying Krishma, it's like bringing a carbon. And by bringing a carbon, it's like doing, accomplishing what the Beis Hamikdash is meant to accomplish. So what Yaakov Avinu was doing is saying, we have to start rebuilding the Beis Hamikdash. What do we have to do? We have to bring a carbon. If I can't bring a carbon literally, I have to say Shema, which is the idea of Mesiris Nefesh, which is the idea of a carbon. So Yaakov Avinu was not only not crying, not only did he say, I'm not going to cry because I have to build my Beis Hamikdash, he actually right away goes and says Shema. So this pshat of Rashi that we mentioned earlier, what he was saying Shema, is not only a question, it's actually part of the answer. That as soon as Yosef begins to cry on the Churban Beis Hamikdash, Yaakov says, 1 second, you could cry because it's not Bechelkecha. So cry, but I can't cry. I have to build. And how do I build? By saying Shema. Siddhis Nefesh. So now we understand this whole story so much better. Idea of Yosef and Binyamin crying on each other's shoulders. And Yaakov, Yosef crying on Yosef, and Yosef crying on Yaakov's shoulders. And Yaakov saying Shema, we now understand what was going on. Why they were crying on each other's shoulders, and why Yaakov doesn't cry. Because when it comes to Binyan Beis Hamikdash, if it's our Beis Hamikdash, then we have to work on it and we can't cry. Crying itself is not going to get us anywhere. It'll make us feel good, but that's it. We have one last question. The question is going to be, L'cheira, what's the whole point of doing anything at this point? Yes, they saw in HaKadosh that the Beis Hamikdash was going to be destroyed. So it's too late. L'cheira, chas v'shom. You shouldn't ask the question. Since they saw with Ruach HaKadosh, with divine spirit, they saw divine intuition. They saw that the Mishkan, Shiloh, and the Beis Abot, the Amikdash, were going to be destroyed. Hadekar Nigzer Azem Umayla was ready to decree from above. Uma Ev Shilasis Bazes, so what could still be done? Now the Karom Ruch Hazal, it's not a question at all, because Hazal already told us, Afilu Cher Ev Chadam, and Achaz Al-Tzavari Shalodam, that even if there's a very sharp sword laying on the neck of a person, Al Yimnat, Min Aracham, a person should not refrain from davening to the Eivishter and awaking, arousing the Eivishter's Rachmanis, the Eivishter's mercy. So therefore, Afilu Lachar Gzardin, even after the decree was made, Ev Shir Al Yidei Aved, it is still possible through our work to tear, to rend the Gzardin, the decree, and change it. Like we find the story with Chizkiah. Yeshaya Masarlei Hanavua Shenigzera Chizkiya Yomis. Yeshaya Hanavi comes to Chizkiya, the king, and he tells him that there was a prophecy that it was decreed upon him that he should die. Amar leChizkiya liYeshaya. Chizkiya says to Yeshaya, Kalei Nevuascha Betzei. Complete your Nevuah, finish your Nevuah, and go out of here. In the Sikhi, the Rebbe said that Chizkiya said to Yeshaya, Guten Morgen, Guten Tag, good morning, good day, you know, get out of here. And then, after Yeshaya left, Chizkiya turns to the wall, and that is to Hashem, the Lashon of the Sikhi, mit Nevishn alein, he and the Eibishter himself. So, there was a gzar din that he's going to die. Chizkiya tells Yeshaya, good morning, good talk, you know, get out of here. And then he turns to the wall and he spends a few minutes with the Eibishter himself. And his tefillah helped. Because Yeshaya came back to him and told him, Shamati is tefillah secha, that the Eibishter heard his tefillah. And he was given another 15 years. Literally 15 years of life in this world. So we see from over here that it's never too late. And even after the Gzar Din was made, you could still rip up the Gzar Din through Avodah. And therefore, when it comes to the Churban Beis HaMikdash, a person sees a Churban Beis HaMikdash in their own life, they should not try to cry, they should not cry about it, or not just cry about it, they should do something. In the end of this Sikha, the Rebbe, in the Farbrengen, the Rebbe said, this is why we find that in Lubavitch, there were certain times during Tisha B'Av, certain shois during Tisha B'Av, that things were besimcha. Chayda, the Rebbe asks, even learning Torah is not allowed in certain parts of Torah, are not allowed on Tisha B'Av. So, you know, there's a din of avelis. But the answer is, when it comes to Tisha B'Av, when we're mourning on the Churban Beis HaMikdash, it's not, the avodah is not ba'anacha u'b'chiyah, it's not through crying and sighing, but we have to know that we have to rebuild the Beis HaMikdash, and therefore, the even on Tisha B'Av, you can't cry the whole Tisha B'Av, because then you're going to miss the point. And this leads us to this final Ois HaZvav, which is the practical application. Amru Chazal. Chazal tell us, Kol Deir Shein and Divin Beis HaMikdash B'Yam of Mailin Olav Kilu Yichrive. Every Deir and generation, the Beis HaMikdash was not rebuilt in its time, in its Deir, it is considered as if they themselves destroyed it. Because since they were not able to rebuild it through Tshuva, through Maisim, through Avoida, therefore it's as if it was destroyed in that generation. And this applies to everybody's specific individual Beis HaMikdash. The fact that the Beis HaMikdash HaKloli was not rebuilt in my times, in our times yet, may be rebuilt. Because our individual Beis HaMikdash, our personal Beis HaMikdash is in a state of churban, of destruction. If the person's Avoid, his own Beis HaMikdash was in a state of completion. Mashiach would come and rebuild the Beis HaMikdash HaKloli. But yes, that my Avoid is not Mishleimus, my Beis HaMikdash is in a state of Churban. This affects the Beis HaMikdash HaKloli. By his bonus, however, thinking about this, its purpose and intent is not to sigh about it or cry about it. Kima pulavasi, to do something about it. Hagula pratus obinyan beis hamikdash benafshei, bring himself to his own geula and rebuild his own beis hamikdash in his life. V'alidezeh yimayir v'yamshich es hagula haklolis ubinyan beis hamikdash benkayim. This will hasten and bring down the geula haklolis and the rebuilding of the beis hamikdash in its place. Alidei mashiach tzidkenu v'karev mamish.